Good evening, and welcome to the April 20th, 1993 Planning Board meeting for the town of Cape Elizabeth. As I mentioned just a short time ago, we were discussing about quorum and a number of members needed for certain votes through the agenda this evening, and come to the realization that we typically, the third Tuesday of every month comes during February vacations and April vacations of schools, and people are either away or have other plans. It looks like we're all set. Hopefully Mr. Carter will show up later this evening for one of the last agenda items. The first order of business this evening is the approval of the minutes of the March 16th meeting of the Planning Board. Any discussion, comments, corrections? Judy?
Just a very minor typo on page 2, second paragraph, fifth or sixth line down. When they're talking about the gate locations, sentence begins on the previous line, the gate locations will have to then insert be fixed and cannot be left in flux. Otherwise, they look fine.
Which paragraph was that in?
Second paragraph.
Yeah. Gate locations.
Sixth line.
Okay. Any other comments? Questions, corrections? If none, do I hear a motion?
So moved.
It's moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor accepting the minutes of the Planning Board meeting of March 16th, 1993, with the one amendment, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? Unanimous vote. We'll review the correspondence received during the past month. First, the Currents newsletter for winter 1993. The Environment and Development newsletter, April 1993. A letter from the Public Works Director in reference to Beale's Ice Cream, dealing with the sewer hookup possibilities of that site. A letter from Mrs. Dudley in reference to Regosa Rose subdivision and her interest in that property. A memo from Mike, the town manager, Mike McGovern, in reference to the Regosa Corporation and the financial capability and ability. We now have the town manager review some of the financial capability criteria to circumvent having to have financial data become public record as part of a public review. So the town manager does some of that review. Next, an article on designing pedestrian-friendly streets. Before the ordinance committee is an ordinance changing the road classification ordinance sent by the Planning Board. Did they get a copy of this also? Thank you. A letter from the town attorney on the Wild Rose subdivision, dated April 13th. And on the podium tonight, a memo from Peter Greenleaf, Drummond & Drummond, indicating his 100% ownership of the Regosa Corporation. Also received, personally received, a letter from the Wells Reserve on some programs. The only one left in that, the Wells Reserve Spring Lecture Series on April 22nd is a Earth Day seminar. If you're interested in that, see me and you can have that for sure. Also delivered to the podium from dealing with the Great Pond Link, which is not a golf course, it's a walkway. A bridge design. And I remind the Planning Board members to take a look at the Planning Board's schedule for the next 5 months, actually the next 4 months, with workshops and meeting schedules or tentative schedules. It's a big help to have Maureen give those to us. Any other correspondence to be submitted by board members? Okay. First order of old business this evening is the Highland Subdivision Amendments request by Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for amendments to the previously approved Highlands a 20-lot subdivision located in the area of Two Lights Road, Winding Way, Hunts Point Road, and Channel View Road. Tonight we have a public hearing, ordinance section 16-2-5. I think before we start the public meeting, or the public hearing, excuse me, I would like to have the applicant or a representative of the applicant come to the podium and just real briefly summarize the last or the changes made in the last month.
Chairman Paul Frenschko, for.
Okay, thank you. And we have reviewed the reason for Mr. Parkhurst excusing himself due to a conflict of interest. Leaves us with three.
Yeah, I was going to ask you if you'd like to wait and see if maybe your additional member might arrive. Or
I don't think we'll wait because the situation probably won't get any better. I'm giving up hope on his arrival. Three board members, there's an interpretation, I was going over this with Maureen, are enough to proceed. We have to have four members to open a meeting. Three members, I believe, requires a unanimous vote. But we will proceed with three board members.
For simplicity, Mr. Chairman, I'd like Mr. John Swan of Owen Haskell, the engineer in the project, to simply review with the board the minor changes proposed by the applicant. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For the record, my name is John Swan. I'm a surveyor with Owen Haskell. The letter dated April 1st to the town planner outlines the changes that have been made to the project since our previous submission. Lot 4 has two gate locations and two corresponding building locations. What we've indicated that if building envelope 4A is used, the gate will be placed as shown on the plan, and also if the building envelope 4B, there's a corresponding gate location for that envelope. There was supplemental wetlands restoration plan, supplemental data, which is dated March 30th, has been submitted. And we also included reduced scale drawings, colored, indicating the major amendment to the plan that we're asking for, and that was the relocation of the emergency access road. The only other item, and it is not shown on the plan, but it is in discussions with the DEP. The DEP is requesting the side slope for the emergency access road be reduced from 3-1 to 2.5-1, only as that emergency access road goes through the wetland area. So we're proposing to do that, and we are proposing to change all the necessary drawings if, in fact, the town agrees with what the DEP is requiring us to do. So those are the only changes that have been made since the last month's submission.
Thank you very much.
We can borrow the color plan that we gave to the board last meeting. We'll put it up here so anyone wants to ask questions.
I'll let you have my copy. Now that Mr. Carter has arrived, I will appoint Peter Carter as the voting member for this this item of the agenda. Having four members, it will not require a full unanimous vote. Any action? At this time, before I open the public hearing, I'd like to remind the board members that one of the reasons for a public hearing is that we get to hear public concerns. I think items and issues brought up in a public hearing are issues to be discussed and talked about by the board members. I urge you to take notes. I also read from the conduct of meetings section of, just real briefly, from our planning board rules and regulations. Under public meetings, it says, members of the public wishing to address the board concerning an agenda item shall wait until the chairman asks for a public comment. When recognized by the chair, the person shall state his or her name and address in an audible tone for the record. The person shall limit his or her remarks to the issue under discussion. The second section of that talks about issues under discussion. I'd like to make sure that any members of the public limit their public comment to the issues before the board dealing with the amendments to a previously approved subdivision plan. At this time, I'll open the public hearing for any public comment. Any members of the public would like to speak to the planning board? Yes, sir. If you could just make sure that you identify yourself for the record.
Tough job, but somebody's got to do it. Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Madam Town Planner, and members of the planning board. My name is Bruce Gasquet. I'm a resident of 82 Hunts Point Road, and I'm an abutter to Lot 4 at the Highlands at Broad Cove, Phase 1. I've watched this project develop over the past 5 years. First, with interest, I supported the developer in this project. I thought it was a good use of the land, and the plan seemed viable, number of house lots, etc. Since that time, I've now watched it with alarm. I've watched as the developer surreptitiously excavated the road last August on a Saturday without posting all the performance bonds and guarantees with the town. I watched as buffer strips were denuded between lots, the road was placed in the wrong location, and wetlands were filled. No one instructed the developer to place the road where he put it. No one told him to fill wetlands and remove buffer strips between lots. Cleared areas in Phase 1 are now more than 100 feet wide. What happened to the narrow gravel access road that was proposed to have been created? What has happened to minimal impact of the environment? Jordan Pond Road used to be a pretty environmentally viable area. It used to be a pleasure to walk down that road. In my estimation, and I'm not an environmentalist and not an expert, it's a disaster out there right now. All I've heard about since the start of this project were the rights of the developer. When do the rights of the developer become subordinated to the rights of the town and its citizens? When do the rights of the developer become subordinated to the rights of the abutters? I ask you not to let this plan for the development be changed any further than it already is. I have a closet of plans for this at home. It's been going on for 5 years, as you well know. I really appreciate the support of the planning board in this matter and their diligence in watching out for this project. We're only in the start of Phase 1 here. If the developer is not checked and controlled at this point, what does this bode for Phase 2 and for this entire project? I ask you not to change the location of gated gravel access roads, not to move the road. If you've walked out there now, particularly after this latest rainfall, it is an environmental disaster. It looks like somebody napalmed the whole area. Please, please take the abutters and the neighbors and the neighbors in Broad Cove's concerns into play here. We're not asking that this not be developed. We're just asking that this not continue to be changed on and on and on again. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Gaskin. Any other members of the public wishing to speak? Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Edsel and members of the planning board, my name is Louise Sullivan. I live at 72 Two Lights Road. And our position has been all along not to support the plan, which is now passed. However, I feel that because that plan has passed, Mr. Kennedy has made a contract with the planning board. And he's established a relationship of trust with you, and by establishing that, a relationship of trust with the townspeople. And we're here tonight because there are violations of that contract of agreed trust. It's a great concern to the people on Two Lights Road, but a greater concern to me right now is that the planning board has also established a relationship of trust with the citizens of Cape Elizabeth in allowing the gated gravel access road and saying that's what will be. I have heard, it's come to my ears, that the town is pursuing having that road paved with the idea eventually of opening it through as a through access. I hope that the planning board will respect the relationship of trust that the town has, you have established with the citizens of the town, and not let that happen. I hope we have this road. It's making some people unhappy, makes me really unhappy, but I hope it remains a gated gravel road and not a paved through access. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mrs. Sullivan. Any other members of the public wishing to make public comment? Yes, sir.
My name is Bob Packer. I live at 21 Hunts Point Road. The only thing that bothers me about this whole situation with all the changes, Mr. Kennedy did some things that the town did not agree with, and he agreed to pay a fine of $2,000 for his whatever he did. Anything that's done now, are we just going to say, okay, do it again, and we'll, you know, fine you, and we'll accept the fine? And, you know, how far is this going to go on? So I think Mr. Kennedy should be held accountable for what he's going to do and what's really going to happen. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Packer. Any other public comment from public citizens? Yes, sir.
Mr. Edsel, my name is Chris Tainter. I live at 6 Jordan Farm Road in Cape Elizabeth. My principal concern here is with the issue of paving that Mrs. Sullivan discussed already. I had the opportunity to look through the files in the town planner's office today for some period of time, looking at the issues, what's been discussed with regard to the issue of paving. And it seems to me, from what I can tell, that there have been three possible justifications advanced for paving what was originally, and what I understood when I purchased my property, to be a gravel access road. One of those is the belief by Mr. Malley, I guess the director of Public Works, that it would make it cheaper and easier to maintain the gravel road if it were paved. I can't really speak to that. The letter that I saw from him to the town planner seemed sort of equivocal in that regard, and it wasn't clear to me that there was going to be any real legitimate cost saving, and I'd like that. That's something that I think ought to be fleshed out before the board considers paving the road. There's also a suggestion, I think, that, and I've spoken with Mr. McGovern about this, that the town at the present time doesn't own any gravel roads, and everything that the town owns and maintains is paved, and this would sort of bring it into compliance with the town's own standards. My reading of the subdivision ordinance suggests to me that even if the access road were paved, that would not bring it into compliance with any of the town's standards, since I think it would have to be a minimum of 24 feet wide, and perhaps as wide as 28 feet to be in compliance with the town standards. And from what I understand, the DEP might allow it to be paved, but only to a width of 18 feet. So there still would not be the kind of compliance that I think the town planner was looking for. The third, and I think the most important thing from my point of view, is the issue of the impact on the wetlands. And I had the opportunity to look back at what the DEP said about that issue about 16 months ago. And I think the DEP was clear in saying that the paving of that road would unreasonably interfere with the existing scenic and aesthetic appearance of the surrounding landscape, and also that paving the road would unreasonably harm the freshwater wetland plant habitat and functions in the area. And I haven't seen anything in the file that gives any different information or that would suggest that what the DEP said back in December of 1991 isn't the case. I don't know what the procedure is at meetings of this kind. I've never been to one before. My hope is that at some point, if the board is seriously considering requiring Mr. Kennedy to pave the road as a condition of the amendments, of granting approval of the amendments that he's seeking, that the, someone from the board or someone in town government address those issues, because they haven't been addressed to my satisfaction.
Excuse me, typically I don't interrupt in public comment, but the first part of your third comment, can you just go back over those, the issues that you were...
Sure. The DEP, and I'm looking at it, what I had gotten from the town office today, which is a document dated December 6, 1991, signed by Commissioner Marriott of the DEP, indicated that paving, when he denied Mr. Kennedy the initial application to pave the road, he concluded, or the DEP concluded, that paving the road would unreasonably interfere with the existing scenic and aesthetic appearance of the surrounding landscape, and also that the proposed activity would unreasonably harm freshwater, wetland, plant habitat, and functions, in that the runoff from a paved road would more directly and adversely impact on the wetlands. And what I saw today in the, and this is the first time I've had the opportunity to look at it, but in the memorandum that was circulated by the town planner to the board, proposed what I understood to be a finding of fact, which was that paving the road would actually cause less environmental harm than having a gravel road. And at least from what I've seen from the DEP, the case is to the contrary, and there's nothing that I've seen that suggests that that's not, that what the DEP said back in December of 91 isn't true. So if something's changed, or if the scientific conclusions have changed, or if somebody has reason to believe that paving the road wouldn't harm the wetlands more than having a gravel road, then I'd just be interested in hearing what that evidence is. To be perfectly candid, my greatest interest in this thing is to make sure, and I just bought a lot on it's lot 3 in phase 1A of the subdivision, and I've been living there for a few months, and I want to make sure at all costs that there's never a through road that goes through there, and I understand the town is interested in having a through road. What I sort of see this desire to pave the road, even though it's only going to be 18 feet wide at this point, is sort of a step in the direction of creating a situation where someday people will feel comfortable making that a through road. And with small children there, buying a piece of property that we believed was going to be and anticipated was going to be a dead end for that very purpose, that's very alarming to us as landowners and as parents. So those are the concerns that I have, and I don't know whether this is the forum in which the town planner or somebody else discusses what the evidence is and what the concerns are, but those are simply the concerns that my wife and I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stair. The forum is that after the public hearing is held, and then the discussion takes place at that time. Any other members of the public wish to make a comment?
Can I ask you a question? When you are discussing...
You could just come to the podium, just because it needs to be recorded.
Seems silly to come here for just this little question. When you're discussing, may we discuss with you?
No, it's not an open debate.
Okay.
That's what the public hearing is for, you to make a comment at this time. Then the public hearing is closed. Typically, I ask the applicant to return to the podium and answer the questions, and then open it to board discussion. But public hearings never become public debate.
Okay. Or just even
no.
To be allowed to ask a question.
No, I'd rather you ask your questions at this point in time rather than opening and closing a public hearing.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. Any other members of the public would like to make a comment? Yes, ma'am.
My name's Sue Pierce, and we live at 74 Hunts Point Road. And I haven't been involved in the project from the beginning. We've been at our house for 2 years, and we directly have our property abuts the property behind us. That's for discussion. I guess my biggest concern is that from what I've heard, things have been done, the road has been changed, and then, you know, the DEP had one plan, the town had another plan, and the road was put somewhere else. And my concern is that if this is in the beginning of the project and it was settled from an $8,000 fine down to $2,000. What's going to happen as the project moves on? What's going to happen with the lots? Are they going to be changed when the road is changed? Is the whole plan going to continue to be changed as we go on? It's only phase one, so my concern is, you know, how will it be controlled that what's agreed upon will actually happen versus changes being made and just fines being, Mr. Kennedy being fined and negotiating down with the town, you know, by 25% of what the original fines are. So that's my concern.
Thank you very much. Any other members like to make public comment? Seeing and hearing none, I close the public hearing. Just as a quick review before I bring the applicant back to the podium, Mr. Zagaski had concerns about so-called disastrous development of the site, which not to move the road, not to move the gated area. Mrs. Sullivan from Two Lights Road talked about a contract of trust between the developer, the town, and the butters to the property, and wished to see a gated gravel access road. Mr. Packer, or Parker, I think it was Packer, from 21 Hunts Point Road, talked about the applicant did things in violation of the plan and was fined only $2,000. Want to know how much further this type of activity goes. I believe it's Tater from Jordan Road, Lot 3, discussed three different issues dealing primarily with the paving issue, breaking into Mr. O'Malley's comment about it being cheaper, the comment being like all other town roads, bringing in a conformity, and the fact that the gravel road may protect the aesthetics and the asphalt may harm the wetlands. Mrs. Sullivan returned to the podium asking about the forum of public debate. Mrs. Pierce, or Sue Pierce, from Hunts Point Road, talked about the number of different changes that had taken place and violations or what appeared to be violations of the approved site plan. Want to know how future changes or violations might be controlled. This time I'd like to have the applicant or representative return to the podium, try to respond to some of those questions, and I'd urge board members, if you have questions, I'm sure Mr. Frinsco won't mind us asking questions as he proceeds through those.
Not a bit, Mr. Chairman. I don't propose to stand here this evening, since I don't think it's the appropriate forum, to discuss alleged violations of the plan. Everyone on this board and every member of your staff knows, and anyone who wished to could find out, that the alleged violations came about because the plans approved by the town, approved by the town engineer, approved by the DEP, actually showed the location of the road too close to the wetland. And it was only when the road was constructed in the field that it became obvious that the road could not be built in the location shown on the plan. That's one of the reasons why we're back here today. Enforcement action is behind us. I think I would leave it open to anyone who wishes to discuss this with the town attorney, the town manager, and the code enforcement officer. They can learn the facts, and I'd be happy to respond to questions, although I believe, and I think your attorney believes, that those discussions are not appropriate before this board. But in the appropriate forum, I'd be happy to respond. With respect to the issues raised by Mrs. Sullivan and Mr. Tainter, as you folks know, as we've said to you publicly, and as we've written to your attorney, we believe that we have entered into a contract with the town and with those persons who have purchased pursuant to the plan. And that representation made by the town and by the developer is that the road will be a gated gravel access emergency road. I want everyone to understand the applicant has not requested an amendment to the plan to pave that road. The applicant does not request it this evening. and the applicant does not believe an appropriate subject before this board. We propose to leave the road just as originally designed, both in material, size, and location, and controlled access. Now, any questions I can answer?
I was just going to ask you about the consensus of the board. Would you like to ask questions as we're on each subject, as Mr. Frinsco goes over them, dealing with the paving of the road or the gates?
Well, I can't answer questions regarding the paving of the road because we didn't advance the proposal.
Exactly, okay.
I'd just assume wait.
Okay, why don't you, other board members? Okay, why don't we you proceed through your response to those concerns from the public here, and then we'll...
I have responded to all the concerns that I heard, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, very good.
I also should say I have Mr. Swan is here for technical questions, and Mr. Kennedy is here for any development questions.
Sure. Let's have some board questions, discussion. Anybody like to lead off? Not everybody jump in at once. Judy?
Mr. Chairman, I have a hard time discussing this plan right now because when we left the last meeting, I know we're here for a public hearing, and I'm glad we had that, but we left the last meeting with a number of things that I thought had to be resolved. One of the major ones was I thought we were expecting DEP approval before we took any further action. I still feel strongly about having that. After reading the town engineer's new comments, that there are still a lot of issues that need to be resolved, and I feel very uncomfortable continually looking at plans that I know are going to be changed, and then either we have a proposed motion to perhaps approve what the applicant has put forth with numerous conditions, which I absolutely am against. But I would like, if we get to some point and table this application, that the applicant will not come back until these issues are addressed. I can go down a long list. I don't see what the point of that is necessarily.
We have people here to respond to any
comments. I think if you have technical questions, I think this, there, and you mentioned that last month, that I think, and I certainly honor your opinion, but I think this is also the time if we have questions, that we can ask those questions now, rather than waiting for any final DEP approval.
Okay, I can go over it again. I will not vote in favor without DEP approval because of this confusion over plans. I don't understand how it could happen that we have one set of plans and DEP has another, and I want to see the DEP plans and look at them and know I'm looking at the same plans.
We can give you a status report on that, Mr. Chairman, or if you want to list them all, we could do it. I thought we were going to do it one by one.
How do you stand with DEP now? Mr. Swan's letter had said we expected approval before tonight.
My discussions with the DEP are that you're right, we do not have the order. The DEP has reviewed the project, have the comments back. The only comment that has been relayed to me was the one that I addressed in the letter to the town planner indicating that they wanted the side slopes reduced to 2.5 to 1. Because of the holiday and because of the state shutdown day and because of the major staff person of the DEP being away for a month, we do not have the written order. But my understanding is the only issue is the side slopes 2.5 to 1, and we expect to have the order within a week.
As far as you know, they are not particularly concerned with letting the lot owner decide the gate location?
We didn't, on our latest plan, we have taken that option away from the lot owner, and we have indicated 2 building envelopes and corresponding gate locations.
But you have not heard if they don't care if
they
the...
Did. The only issue that they mentioned was the side slopes to me.
I may answer that, and Maureen can attest to this. In December, when we met with the town engineer, Squaw Bay Corp, myself, Jim Casita, DEP, Linda Kochmuller, DEP, Linda Kochmuller's comment as to the gate location was, she says, I don't care where the gate location is. Now, if I'm paraphrasing that incorrectly, maybe Maureen could correct that.
I think I will ask for next time whether it comes from DEP or town staff. I'm somewhat at a loss what the purpose of the gate is for. If it's simply to restrict through traffic, I don't see why we don't have one gate. If it's something other that a certain number of vehicles is going to create more hazard for the wetland. I don't see allowing a lot owner to move it and have subsequently much less wetland protected if that's the case, and also a much longer area without a turnaround. I would like someone to give me an answer what the whole purpose of this gated access is. I don't understand. I don't understand why the town is pushing for paving. I don't understand why it wouldn't be a through road. I don't understand why it would be very restricted, because I've heard so many different testimonials. Perhaps if the applicant would give it your best shot, what you think the purpose of the gates are, and if staff could present something, if that's not too much to ask.
Sure, that's fine.
The best answer for that is the planning board itself. The road was originally approved as a limited access road.
I do not understand why.
Well, Maureen can explain.
I think perhaps Maureen can explain the history of that item.
My understanding is since the 1970s, the town has been struggling to achieve a second access to the Broad Cove neighborhood. Concern being that there are over 100 homes in that area, there's only one way in, and there have been instances in the past where that one way in has been blocked for various reasons, and it's just a public safety interest in finding a way to get a second means of access into a neighborhood where in the 1960s it was originally designed as having two access points, and because of a variety of circumstances that second road, which we're now looking at, was never constructed. When Mr. Kennedy came to the town with this proposal, it was made very clear to him that a second means of access would be expected to be accomplished as part of this subdivision approval. As part of the preliminary approval, there was a second means designed that came in at a different point from Hunts Point Road. The DEP, who also has jurisdiction to review this subdivision, looked that over and refused to approve that particular location. The DEP has been very reluctant from the beginning to approve any through road because they don't want to see a road go through this wetland area. The compromise was that the DEP recognized the town's strong interest in providing a second means of access for emergency access reasons. And the compromise was that even though they wanted to protect the wetlands, they would allow a road in. But because the town needed a road primarily for emergency access reasons, it was only going to be an emergency access road, not a through road. So that the town compromised and that they didn't get their through road, DEP compromised and that they didn't get no road at all. The reason that the DEP gave for keeping the road gravel was primarily aesthetic concerns and also concerns with the wetland. Since that time, the town and through Mr. Kennedy and myself have been working with DEP, and also another bureau in DEP, the Water Bureau, has been doing a lot of work in terms of evaluating impacts on wetlands, and there is a lot of emerging new evidence that suggests that the runoff from a lightly traveled paved road would be much less detrimental than the runoff from a gravel road, because the gravel road has a lot of sediments that can fill in the wetland, whereas the kind of runoff you get from a paved road basically is due to how much traffic travels over it, and you get the kind of pollutants that tend to fall off of cars, basically. So if you have not many cars traveling on this road, then the runoff shouldn't be as noxious as it would be from a heavily traveled road. So kind of really quickly, that's where we are right now. But in the most recent set of revisions that the applicant has requested, DEP is again looking at this plan. They've got some new evidence, and they've told the town that they're reevaluating the prescription against paving it. But as far as I'm aware, the town has made no effort whatsoever to make this a through road since the initial compromise when this application was approved. And there's no effort to make it a road that would meet current town road standards. The standards that are being referred to are the fire lane standards the town has, which prescribe an 18-foot wide road that is paved.
Okay, given that, I still do not see the need for a second gate, because if it's just limiting access, one gate does it as well as two. If this is an emergency access road, two gates slow down the emergency vehicles. I also would hate the homeowners to go home thinking that whatever we decide here 3 months from now, that will never be a through road. I'm not comfortable that will never happen, whether the town is not requesting that or not. Things changed. People, some of you requested not to see further changes. The applicant has every right to come forward, ideally not under violation reasons, but coming forward to make changes, and that's his right, and the planning board will review that. But I, given the history of this, I don't know what will happen with this road. I hope it's in accordance with plans, but I don't know what to say.
As proposed, and as proposed in the amendments, it is in accordance with the plan.
I understand that. I understand what you're proposing.
The application is not proposing to pave the road.
I know that, Mr.
With regard to the location of the gates, rather than the reason for the gates, the location of the gates is designed to prevent the existence of a dead-end road beyond an inhabited house. Concept is to install the gates near the location of where the driveway would be accessing the dwelling at the site to prevent having a stretch of uninhabited dark road that someone could use for whatever mischief they might deem appropriate. So the concept of the location of the gates is to keep access beyond the last inhabited house to a minimum.
Okay.
And you have to do that on both ends to be successful, to be quite frank with you.
I don't think that...
Both access points.
I don't think that became as questionable until the second building window in, what is it, Lot 4?
Yes, sir.
Brought that gate further down the road. And mm-hmm. So you actually, if they build in the second window, the furthest southwest, I guess it would be. Can't remember which direction I'm looking. You could have a very short distance of road between the gates. Otherwise, it's about 800 feet, which is a reasonable... cars don't get down in there. There's no turnaround plan as there's a hammerhead on the other end. And you have people backing off the road.
You back into a driveway. That's what the...
In this case,
yes.
With a gate at the close to that driveway access. And not until there were two options on lot number four did that become problematic, because they're quite a distance apart.
Okay. Some of my other comments I had asked last meeting, I believe it was, to understand the rationale for revising the landscaping at the entrance of that road, and I haven't heard a response to that. The issue of requiring a performance guarantee for the wetlands restoration was raised, and I think a couple board members said we strongly favor that, and I haven't heard any more of that, a proposed cost and what the guarantee would...
I can only handle about two at a time.
Okay.
On the first issue, I don't know if you recall, but the abutting property owners at the intersection of the new road with Two Lights Road wanted to try to preserve the existing landscaping to the extent possible, the existing natural buffer at that location. And the planting plan, which the planning board requested the developer to do, would, in order to physically plant the plantings, would require the removal of a substantial amount of the existing natural growth. And so, in order to maintain that buffer, that natural buffer, that's the reason for the submission of the amendments to the planting plan.
Was it originally assumed that those plants would be taken out?
Yes.
Why is the road relocated there?
No, Mr. Kennedy can explain it. In order to plant them, you have to take them out.
When Jordan Farm Road was initially designed, the elevation of Two Lights Road was determined in the field to be 1 foot higher than it was presumed to be. That eliminated the need for a very sharp slope coming down to the road about at a station like 300, I think it was 250 to 300. In fact, the original plan showed a riprap section because it was thought to be it was going to be a steep slope. When we built the road, we conferred with the town engineer and Bob Malley and discussed the Two Lights Road elevation, and became apparent that if we were very careful around the existing vegetation, we wouldn't have to disturb any. And that's in fact what happened. We preserved the existing vegetation, and we were able not to have the road lowered and have a side slope that couldn't be maintained and would have to be landscaped extensively.
Maureen, have you heard from the abutters, you had pointed out that the proposed trees were requested by the abutters.
No, I haven't heard from them. I do remember during the final subdivision approval process that they, Mr. Brown, I think it was very involved and concerned about that. I think Mr. Kennedy probably remembers that as well.
Yeah, Mr. and Mrs. Brown are the son and daughter-in-law
right.
of the owner of the abutting property.
Mm-hmm.
And they came in, and they were the ones who made the request. And their concern was they had an existing natural buffer, even though it wasn't on their property. It was an existing natural buffer, and they wanted to try to preserve that as much as possible between their mother's house and the new junction at Two Lights Road.
Okay, thank you.
On the performance guarantee, we submitted the performance guarantee, the wetlands alteration plan amendments. We have, at our last meeting, agreed and notified you that Steve Moore would be our wetland consultant who mm-hmm. prepared the plan, and that we had prepared the plan in conjunction with consultation with Ross Cudlitz of SCS, and we were happy to accept Mr. Cudlitz as an additional reviewing agent for implementation of the plan. The one thing we need to do the performance guarantee is the planning board under your ordinance is to establish the amount. The treasurer, town manager, town attorney will approve the performance guarantee document.
Typically, though, we have some proposal for an amount that, I don't know if it's a town engineer, somebody reviews and says that's reasonable.
Surely.
We cannot set it without you giving us the information and having staff verify that. So we would be looking for that next meeting. And I would urge you to do it in consultation with whoever's the appropriate staff.
As far as the estimate
goes? Yes. Because
I believe that was submitted in the February application.
March 30th, I think.
Was that just the materials, or did that have the labor and the monitoring? It did?
Everything. A very complete, well-documented, I thought, wetlands mitigation plan.
Yeah. Right, we assumed you'd reviewed it.
Okay, I didn't think so. I didn't think it had the cost for the monitoring and the labor and all that. So, whatever, that does need to be resolved, and if it's there, then it can be brought to staff's attention. Thank you. Let me see if I had... There, in the memo of last month again, there was a request for signed right-of-way deeds for Phase 1A and 2B. I didn't know if those were proceeding.
I have discussed that with Mr. Hill, and I think he and I have reached agreement on how we do it.
Okay, I will be looking for confirmation from staff on that. And just in general, to address all the most recent town engineers' comments, and I certainly would be looking for revised plans with the revised side slopes before we approve anything. And I think that's it for now.
Okay. Thank you, Judy. Other comments? Mark?
I have a question. This relates to a previous item which we have considered, which was the approval of the minutes from the past meeting, which I will quote from at this point for Mr. Frinsko's comment. On the second page, in the fourth paragraph, we have an item which says, Mr. Frinsko replied that the application from the board does not include a request to pave the road, period. From day one, Mr. Kennedy has told the board that the developer will cooperate with the town if the town wishes to have the road paved, without attributing that quote. And from what I'm hearing tonight, I don't think it came from you.
No, I think the minutes, I have not seen the draft minutes.
So I was just wondering if
but the context
background
is the statement I made was the proposed amendments from the applicant to the board do not include any alteration of the road with respect to paving. That is something that if the town accepts the road, which it may or may not do, and if the town wants to pursue paving,
oh, okay.
That's out of our control.
That was the way I understood your comments last
yes,
month,
that
and that's the way
time.
It's shown in the minutes.
We really don't want to be drawn into this debate if we can possibly help it.
Right.
Okay.
I have one other question which perhaps Mr. Swan could best address. In reviewing the movement of the road
mm-hmm.
and the side slopes, we were given a couple months ago now a set of plans, C-102, beginning with C-102, dated, it's going to be two or three months ago at this point. The last set of plans we had about 3 months ago, which included road sections. The April 2nd set of plans just shows the realignment of the road, but not the sections through the various station points of the road. The road has been proposed to move further north, I believe.
That's correct.
And it appears to be moving slightly uphill at the same time.
The
topography in that area generally slopes north to south to the wetlands. Mm-hmm. Does the combination of the road being moved to a higher elevation and the side slope being made steeper mean that the toe of the slope has not moved further into the wetland? And is the toe of the slope that we saw on the plans a couple months ago, the last batch that had sections, is that the toe of the slope according to what we're seeing colored up now, or is that the toe of the slope from some package that went
to some agency
a year ago?
The last plans that you have that had sections reflect the relocated road. They do not reflect proposed adjusted 3:1 to 2.5:1 side slope.
Right, but they do reflect the road in its new, more northerly location.
Yes.
And how do those toes relate to the original toes of slopes from before the road was shifted north?
They change, but if in fact you take the 2.5:1 in the wetlands area, they probably don't change that much. The one issue, and I believe the town engineer raised it, was in the area near the turnaround on the easterly end of the Farm Pond Road, where we provided for a drainage easement. That's the only area where the toe slope it was determined by our engineers and the town engineers that it might be critical. Other than that, there was plenty of room in the right-of-way to accommodate the relocation.
Thank you very much.
Any other comments, Mr. Cotter? Any questions? Judy, anything else?
The only really question I have is, again, with the relocation of the gates, and it's not even that so much as the original design, where we had a turnaround at the Two Lights Road end of the development, and then we had a cul-de-sac of sorts on the other end of the development, the Broad Cove. But beyond that cul-de-sac, there was and still will be access to two lots. Why, I assume, public safety or the fire department requires such a large turnaround, kind of moving into the wetlands on one end and doesn't need it on the other, and is a turnaround appropriate on lot 4? Just like on a public access waiver. It just seems strange to me that we have this huge turnaround on one end and don't have the need for it on the other side, and if we don't have a need for it, why we needed it in the first place?
I think the turnaround on the, and this is just my opinion, on the Jordan Road side, comes off from Two Lights Road and is much more susceptible to sightseers going down Two Lights Road, turning in to Jordan Way. The other end is almost an obscure turn to the right to get in there, and not as noticeable as I suppose inner subdivision traffic could get mistaken and go in that way. It's a good question whether a turnaround number 1 could be placed at the time of a plan approval to match a future driveway, and whether that can stay out of the wetlands and cause less damage. I don't know, but I don't think it was ever discussed to have a turnaround on that end.
Maureen might
be able to bring more history to it.
It's one of the issues that's been raised with the DEP. Unless we were talking about the wrong section of the plan, my understanding is that DEP says at one time there was a turnaround on their plan.
The Broad Cove path?
Yeah, but there's a lot of things that we're still trying to nail down. I agree with you. It looks awkward, and I'm concerned that people are going to drive down to lot 4 and think they're going to make it all the way through, and then what are they going to do when they get down to the end?
Okay. Question of my own. If the applicant could just bring my... I've been with us, I think, since almost the beginning. How we came to deciding on the chain and post being the type of gate that we would end up with. Can you give me a little history? I remember seeing drawings of crash gates and fancy corral gates and everything else, but how did we end up where we're at? I'm concerned about the safety side of it. The car's proceeding with a rusted chain that you can't see real well at night. How did we get to that chain and post?
My recollection serves me. We originally proposed a Williamsburg-type gate with a crash piece that could be pushed open in an emergency vehicle and on they go. The negatives to that were maintenance by the town. The town, anybody could just really open it, and it would stay open. And it was felt, particularly, I believe, by Bob Malley, that the chain and the posts with a lock would be more durable, easier for the fire truck or the ambulance to put back up and not have to worry about the maintenance. Aesthetically, I couldn't agree with you more. I thought the gates were a terrific idea, but it fell on deaf ears.
Maureen, do you remember from the staff? Okay. I guess my general comments, going back to some of the comments from the public hearing dealing with the actual movement of the road, we've said very little about the movement of the road itself. I guess as the applicant comes back to the board, whether the road has been moved 10 feet or 100 feet or however many feet it's actually physically been moved, I think the issue really is a case of deteriorating confidence in the developer, both by the planning board, by the public, as to what we're actually going to see from there, whether it's a mistake, whether there were two plans, whether three plans. Number one that's caused some irritation, as you probably could sense, from planning board members dealing with this the second time or third time or numerous times around. The sense of frustration and perhaps anger from the general public. What's going to happen next? Some of those answers, it's questions we don't have answers for. My own, as just one planning board member, my opinion on the unpaved gated access road, I have no intention of suggesting it being paved. I think that was a town staff suggestion. I usually side with town staff at their recommendations. I can't see where it's beneficial in this situation to actually pave the road. I don't necessarily agree with the DEP's recommendation. Sometimes the DEP brings us good, sound advice, and sometimes I'd rather they stay out of some of our business. Again, I guess as one planning board member, I'm looking at an unpaved, gated, limited access, emergency access road. We don't need to go back through the history of the whole project to go through the decision. I think a key issue for some of the board members here tonight, especially two of the more new board members, are understanding at this point in time what does the board do if it decides to take action. And I think if you have questions, those are legitimate questions as well. Do we approve? Do we table? Do we deny? Approve with the conditions? Our town legal counsel is here if you have questions as to what we should do next. That's important that you, if you have questions about that, that you certainly ask. And now is certainly the time to do that. I guess if, number one, I open it up for a little more discussion. We're almost a half an hour over time on our agenda, but if there's discussion, especially questions dealing either with the application or procedure, just now.
Mr. Edsel?
Yes.
If I could make a comment on the, I guess the reason we're here, you have my complete assurance that I am not going to waver anything on that design plan. I've learned my lesson. I'm not going to reinvent the wheel. If the road is designed in the wrong place, so be it. This has been too expensive. Mm. Too prolonged, and it's just it's a sorry situation. But I felt that road had to be changed, and as it turned out, I was correct. And that's the end of it.
Okay. Any questions, comments, discussion? Questions about procedure? If not, do I hear a motion?
I'll try one.
Okay.
I propose the following motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group for amendments to the Highlands, a 20-lot subdivision located in the area of Two Lights Road, Winding Way, Hunts Point Road, and Channelview Road, be tabled to the regular May 1993 Planning Board meeting, where the following information shall be submitted by the regular May submission deadline. One, executed right-of-way deeds for Jordan Farm Road, Farm Pond Road, and Channel View Road in a form acceptable to the town manager and town attorney in accordance with Appendix B, Item B, 7 of the subdivision ordinance. Two, written confirmation from the Department of Environmental Protection that the proposed subdivision amendments and the proposed wetlands restoration plan are acceptable. Three, that proposed language for the drainage easement to be, that a drainage easement that is to be added to Lot 5 be submitted for review by the town attorney. Four, that the plans be revised in accordance with the April 12, 1993 letter from the town engineer, items 1, 2, and 4, which is attached. And I just found better wording for my point 3, if I could reword that.
Sure, go ahead and go back to them.
That an executed Lot 5 drainage easement deed be submitted in a form acceptable to the town manager and town attorney prior to any construction or site work on the subdivision. Actually, just be submitted. This is for our next meeting. Six, that a schedule for implementation and monitoring of the wetland restoration plan by the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District be established by the applicant. Schedule shall include reports of the district to be submitted to the code enforcement officer. Seven, that a performance guarantee to cover the costs of the wetland restoration plan, including the cost of inspection and monitoring by the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District, be submitted in a form and amount acceptable to the town manager and town attorney. I think I'll leave it at that.
It has been moved. And do I hear a second? Or is there a wish to hear that repeated? Verbatim. Do I hear a second? It's been moved and seconded. Is there further discussion? Discussion. Maureen, did you take notes as you were going down through there? Some of it is easily repeated by...
Maybe missing one, but if I can be allowed to paraphrase, it was a motion for tabling the subdivision application to the regular May meeting and requiring the submission of information by the regular May submission deadline, and that the following information would be submitted. I think the one was the requirement for street deeds for the roads in Phase 1B. Two, that there would be confirmation of DEP approval, including the subdivision amendments and the wetlands restoration plan. Three, that there would be language submitted for the drainage easement, for the easement adjacent to Lot 5. Four, that the items identified by the town engineer in the attached letter, items 1, 2, and 4, be addressed. Five, I admit I missed.
I think I missed a number. Five, okay. I believe, should be the wetland restoration plan.
Okay, good. So that five would be that that the schedule for implementation and monitoring of the wetland restoration plan by the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District be submitted. And then I think the last one was that performance guarantee to cover the costs of the wetlands restoration plan also be submitted.
That's what I'd intended to say.
Okay.
If I would point out one thing, something I have changed in previous motions is I did not mention paving of the road.
Okay. The question of for a tabling order, is there any reason for findings of fact?
No.
I don't think we have any findings.
No.
Okay. Any questions, discussion on the motion and the seconded motion? None appearing. All those in favor of the motion as read and seconded, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. It's been tabled to the May meeting. I think if you followed the conditions, most of it centered around number one, wetlands, number two, approval by the DEP. Certainly you'll get it written, but I just stress that it's quite evident the consensus of the board, and we'd like to hear from the DEP before we take any further action on it. Thank you very much. Next order of business this evening, find my agenda. Thank you. Next order of business is a Great Pond Walkway Wetlands Alteration Permit, request by the Cape Elizabeth Conservation Commission for a wetlands alteration permit to construct a wooden walkway and bridge in the wetland adjacent to the Great Pond. We're here this evening for a public hearing, section 19-3-9. If I could have the applicant introduce yourself and just give a real brief summary of where we left off and what we've done over the last month.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, my name is Patrick Carroll. I'm chairman of the Conservation Commission. And with me tonight is Natalie Burns and Gary Weaver, who have both been very active in the Great Pond Link project over the past few months. We're here tonight actually seeking a special permit, as you know, for to construct a boardwalk and a wooden footbridge across Alewy Brook at the head of Alewy Brook at Great Pond. Just a little background, this project was really conceived as a mini-grant that was given to us through the Casco Bay Estuary Project. And the purpose of this grant was to develop a pedestrian trail to Great Pond and in turn create some interpretive signage and increase the public awareness of wetland ecology and the Great Pond and wetlands in general. As we started developing this trail, the trail itself, as I think you guys all have copies of the original submission, was back in February. The trail itself begins opposite Kettle Cove Drive in on Route 77 and extends in to the property that the Land Trust owns, which borders onto Great Pond. From there, it drops down onto a pedestrian easement across Sprague property and swings around, crossing Alewy Brook and then continuing on up, connecting with Fenway. I guess there's a trail that runs through Fenway. As part of this project, when we started taking a look at laying out the trail, there were a series of existing trails that went off of the Land Trust land onto private land owned by Tuttle and Jordan. And as the Land Trust began to, in their good neighborly way, develop some fencing in order to shut off those trails and restrict our trail back down onto where we do have a public easement, we found out that a portion of the pedestrian easement is within a wetland area. We're looking at about 300 feet, which extends approximately from where the corner of the Land Trust land drops down into the Great Pond area, extending back around 300 feet or so towards Alewy Brook. In looking at several alternatives on trying to bring this trail back up onto higher ground, there really weren't any. We approached landowners, and we looked at trying to pull that trail back up onto higher ground. But the easiest and most effective way to deal with this is really to try to create a boardwalk across that. So we looked at several alternatives on boardwalks, and I think the thing we're trying to do is to create a very minimal impact, provide a minimal amount of public access around the wetland area. And what we've developed is a series of board planking that would be about approximately 2 feet wide, laid on top of what we're considering natural hemlock logs that would be placed on the wetland surface itself, and then these boards would be placed on top of that to provide access. So the intent on the boardwalk itself would be that it would be a very minimal impact. It should not affect any type of surface flows of the water itself and any disturbance of wetland aquatic vegetation. Once we extend back about 300 feet, we get back onto some higher ground, and from there the trail extends back over to Alewife Brook. And that trail was actually constructed last fall through the help of the Cape Elizabeth South Portland Rotary Club, and it's a wonderful trail and will really be a nice link back over. The bridge itself, we're proposing, I think we originally proposed a 32-inch wide clear span across the bridge. We went out and actually measured. We will require about a 16-foot span in order to reach across Alewife Brook at the point where it makes the most sense. There were some early comments about the structural integrity of the bridge and so forth. I did have a structural engineer take a look at our original plans, and we have made some minor modifications. The first one being that the beams themselves, the joists themselves that would span the water, have been upgraded from 2x8s to 2x10s. And the second being that a railing, which was originally proposed, lacks some type of diagonal bracing or bracing in order to resist lateral forces on it. So the structural engineer, based on some design criteria that I think is somewhere around 50 pounds per lineal foot on a railing, which is a state standard, and 85 pounds on live loading on the decking, developed. Basically, we ran the numbers together, and other than those two changes, we have added diagonal bracing to the railing, and we've upgraded the joists themselves to 2x10. Other than that, it does meet all structural requirements according to code. We also looked at, there was a comment last time about, I think it came from the town engineer, about the elevation of the bridge above the water and the ability of flood flows to flow underneath there, and what would happen if we get logs and so forth down underneath there. I spoke at length with a civil engineer about that, and his comments were really that the floodway at that portion of Great Pond and where Alewife Brook really begins is so wide that you're really never going to see high velocity defined channels of floodwaters. What you're going to see is as Great Pond tends to rise in elevation, those waters will tend to fan out and disperse at a very low velocity. So his feeling was, if we begin to raise the bridge up to get above, say, a 25-year storm or flood level, that it would require some abutments and actually, in a sense, what we'd be doing is channeling those floodwaters underneath the bridge rather than allow them to disperse around it. So with that in mind, I think what we intend to do is try to establish an elevation that's somewhere in the neighborhood about 2 feet above a normal water elevation of Alewife Brook at that point, which in its normal state is only about a foot deep. And then we would build up as necessary, probably just using some stones or maybe a couple of logs in order to get access up onto the bridge, and then dropping back down. You know, the intent here is really to create a very minimal impact on the stream bed and on the floodway itself. In reviewing these changes in the bridge at our last Conservation Commission meeting, we also discussed at length the visual impact of this bridge, and I guess at this point we'd like to also request that the board consider the possibility of eliminating the handrails or the railings on the bridge itself. With that in mind, our intent here is really to provide a very low impact crossing of Alewife Brook itself, and we're really not looking for a design statement or a very strong element in the landscape. And the feeling is if we could eliminate the handrails, that it would be a much subtler, much more primitive, and probably much more in keeping with the character of the landscape out there. So I think that's where we stand at this point. I'd like to answer any questions.
Very good. At this point in time, we open it up for a public hearing. Is the next step in the process. Just review the process for conduct of the public hearing. Any members of the public want to address the planning board for a public comment, approach the podium and identify yourself and try to keep the comments to the discussion of the item before the planning board. Are there any members? At this time, I'll open the public hearing on the Great Pond Walkway Wetlands Alteration Permit. Any comment from the public? Seeing and hearing none, I'll close the public hearing, invite the applicant back to the podium, and open up the discussion with the planning board. Any questions, comments? I think at this time I'll also appoint Mr. Carter as a voting member. For the rest of the evening. Thanks. Questions?
One question. The walkway itself is going to remain 3 feet wide. It won't be wide into a greater width.
Well, if that's, you know, it could very easily be widened, say, another planking width or so. I think at this point, the intent would be that the walkway would remain, you know, 36 inches wide.
From previous meetings, I was under the impression that one of the reasons why it was as narrow as it was without any particular traffic across the bridge, other than possibly bicycles.
Well, I think there was some discussion, in fact, initially when it was 32 inches wide, that the board was looking to possibly provide some type of handicap access, and there was a 3-foot minimum dimension, I think, that was discussed at that point. That's actually the reason why we went to a 3-foot width, was to enable, I know it sounds crazy, but to enable, you know, wheelchair access on the bridge if at some point in time that trail were to be made handicap accessible.
But is the likelihood of that happening even possible in the future?
I seriously doubt it. I mean, I think, you know, coming in from the Route 77 side, there's a very steep embankment that the trail has to negotiate down in order to get down to the floodway level. Coming from the other side, I think, you know, ultimately there may be some ways to possibly align a trail in there, but I mean, that's very far in the future, I think, if at all.
It's a stupid question, I know, but does anyone have any idea how wide a set of handlebars on a motorcycle is? Or a dirt bike? I have no idea.
Is that a trivia question?
one of the reasons that we determined to lay the planking parallel with the walkway and parallel with the bridge, rather than perpendicular, is to, in fact, and we have a 2-inch gap in there, is to more or less discourage bicycles from trying to negotiate that, or I guess maybe a 2-inch wide gap would not deter a motorcycle, but it may make him think about it a little bit.
Okay, just as one more member, I guess I feel uncomfortable having the side railings removed. For a number of reasons. One, safety, and the other is, I think, it would just be more inviting for dirt bikes instead of to go across.
Another comment, discussion? Judy?
I'd like to clarify for the board and for the Conservation Commission. I was the main person, I think, that talked about handicapped accessibility. My comment was that if it were likely that that would be required. It made a lot of economic sense to build the bridge accordingly now. I was never pushing the Conservation Commission to build it accordingly, especially if there's no need to. Mm-hmm. I wanted you to understand that. I guess we just got a new footbridge detail on our desks tonight,
right.
But now you're saying this is not what you would actually like to propose, you would like to eliminate?
No, I think the structural portion of that bridge that you have, the new sketch, I think would remain the same. Basically, what we'd propose would be to just eliminate the handrails or the railing from it. So the bottom, the post supports and the joists and the decking and so forth would all basically remain exactly the same.
Now, if you eliminate the handrail, you eliminate the need for the diagonal bracing?
That's correct.
I see. I don't know if I have any strong feelings one way or other about the handrails. I'd have one quick question for Maureen, or maybe both of you. You do not have the NRPA permit yet, is that
not
correct?
Yet. No, it's in the works.
Is there any reason why we cannot go ahead with that? Is there a requirement in what we're looking at that we need that first?
No, there's no requirement that you cannot act independently of them proceeding with that permit. And I guess just as a piece of information for the board, the Meadowview subdivision, which was recently reviewed, also had a bridge detail in it. And the requirement the board put on that was that if at any point the bridge spanned a height that was more than 4 feet above grade, that they would be required to put in a hand railing. Just as a piece of information.
I guess that would be my comment when I see this is going to be 2 feet above the, or approximately 2 feet above water surface or mud surface or whatever's going to be underneath there. The common sense of me says, why have handrails? If you fall off, you fall off and get wet. We try to think in terms of public safety. I'm not sure that it's that much more safe with handrails 2 feet above it. Whatever surface it is. I understand that it is wet. I understand there's some concern to keep trail bikes and et cetera. It's starting to look more like a jungle gym type structure made to climb on. I'm not sure that the benefits outweigh the drawbacks of a handrail. Any other questions, comments? Do I hear a motion? Stephen.
Okay, motion for the board to consider findings of fact number one, that the Cablewood Conservation Commission is requesting review of the construction of a walkway and bridge adjacent to Great Pond, which requires review under section 19-3-9 of the zoning ordinance. Number two, the application substantially complies with standards of section 19-3-9-04. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Conservation Commission for a wetlands alteration permit to construct a catwalk and bridge adjacent to Great Pond be approved.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion?
I assume that the motion as made would require the Conservation Commission to build the bridge as shown on the footbridge detail we received tonight.
It would, unless it's otherwise amended. Is that right, Maureen? You might amend that to...
Yeah, I would propose to Steve to see if he would consider adding a condition that reads that... the footbridge detail shall be revised to eliminate the handrails and revised plan submitted to the planner.
That's fine. I find that acceptable.
Okay. It's been moved, seconded, amended, and approved by the mover. Is there any other discussion? Okay, seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read and amended, please raise your right hand. Those opposed?
unanimous votes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good luck.
I said your right hand. Thank you.
Thought I didn't notice. Third order of business under old business, Beals Ice Cream site plan, request by Beals Old Fashioned Ice Cream for change of use from Fish Farm Market to ice cream store located at 300 Ocean House Road, site plan completeness, section 19-2-10. The applicant would approach the podium and introduce yourself. And I will say for the record that the applicant was before us last month and was not found to be complete. Some other items have been added to the application, and I guess I'd like to have the applicant go over some of those additions, if you could, please.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Pete Malia, and I'm here on behalf of Beals Ice Cream. And with the weather getting warmer, we're anxious to start serving ice cream here in Cape Elizabeth. We hope that we've adequately addressed the items deemed incomplete at the last meeting. And I'd like to start out with some of the items that I think can be easily addressed. The area west of Route 77 has been noted on our site plan. But feel free to ask questions at any time, of course. But these are just site plan additions. An 8x13 handicapped parking space is now depicted on the plan, which is number 6, right in front of the store. Drainage flow arrows for stormwater have been added to the plan. The water line is now noted on the plan. Those were the additions that we were required to make, and we made. The town engineer made some comments, which I'd like to start addressing now. Comment B from the town engineer was that the site distances have been shown on the plan, but the engineer pointed out that the criteria used was slightly different from the criteria that they normally use. And I checked with our engineer, Troy McDonald, and he says that the measurements he uses are the ones that he learned and the ones that he has used since he has been surveying, and he does use them around the state, and apparently there's a slight difference in the ones that T. Lynn uses. I don't think that that would... It's actually 4 inches, I believe, 3 inches, 3 or 4 inches that is different. I don't think that that would cause a major difference in site distances that he has shown on the plan, but that was his explanation for comment B. Comment D states that traffic control signs have not been addressed, and the problem with traffic control signs, as we see it, is that the ideal place to put them would be right here at the end of the driveway, at the intersection of Ocean House Road and the driveway, which is where we would like to put them. That is the right-of-way, however, so we would ask the planning board for permission to put the signs in the right-of-way. Otherwise, we'd have to move them back off of the right-of-way, and I'm not sure if, well, I'm quite sure it would be difficult to see from Ocean House Road, so we would propose to put the directional signs right at the end of the driveway, or near it anyway, so that they could be seen from Ocean House. There was a discussion about lighting last time, and that has been mentioned in the comments by the town engineer. We did go over and turned on the lights, and we feel that the lights that are depicted on the plan are adequate for our use, and of course we would be willing to add more lights if you felt it necessary or even take some away, but we think that what's there right now is fine, and What is there is a 100-watt bulb on the rear of the building. On the left side of the building, there's a 175-watt mercury vapor security light with a light radius of 48 feet. There is a 150-watt, and this is from the our cover letter to the planning board. There is a 150-watt floodlight on the left side of the building, a 100-watt bulb in the middle front of the building, two 150-watt floodlights to the right front, and a 100-watt bulb on the storage building. And the 150-watt floodlights are rated at 60-foot candles with a 60-degree light radius. I believe somebody had a question about that last meeting, so we checked with some lighting authorities and got those figures. And now moving into some of the more substantive issues, I believe...
if I could just butt in here, and excuse me, we're starting to get into some of the technical merit issues, and the first order of business is to go over the completeness issue, and I think what we might do is come back to our planner, and then if we have questions item by item as far as completeness, and I remind the board this is the first order of business is the matter of completeness, deeming the application complete or incomplete, and not questions of technical merit. Typically, we ask the planner to go down the checklist, and for two reasons. I think we won't proceed that way unless there's some type of objection, number one, a matter of time. Number two, there seem to be few issues of partial or not. I don't see any no's. I think I'd like to leave it up to the board members. If you have specific questions, we did go down through the list last month. I think if there are specific issues by the board, if you could ask Maureen, or if you have a question of the applicant on issues of completeness. Judy?
I don't really consider it an issue of completeness, but I want to mention there is not information shown on the sign, simply the location. I can call the plan complete based on that, but I think more needs to be submitted. You could technically call it incomplete, but I don't wish to do that.
I had a similar question coming to my mind when I read through that section. I also will ask Maureen where we stand as far as it being the purview of the board on sign ordinance. Is that still within our purview?
What I'd like to do is just read to you what the site plan regulations say are a submitted site plan requirement. It's not unusual for certain regulations to overlap. It certainly there would be a circumstance where someone would need to use a sign ordinance and get a permit for a sign without generating site plan review. So this is not only an overlap when someone needs site plan review and they're also proposing signs, but in the site plan regulations, it does allow the board to require the location, dimensions, and details of signs. So until I'm instructed otherwise, my interpretation would be that you still have authority to review signs. And that's not the content of the sign. It's basically it's the location, the size, and also because you have authority to review lighting, that's something that gets involved with signs as well.
I guess the only other comment would be the same vein as with respect to landscaping. Mr. Emery brought it up last meeting that he would expect to see some sort of proposal for landscaping. I would also, but what looks to me on the plan is that they're proposing to keep it as is. So again, I don't think it's really a completeness issue.
I think that's what we got to, is if there's no additional plan for landscaping, there's no plans for additional landscaping.
I think so.
Mark?
Yes, my question for completeness centers on the information which we received about the septic system.
Mm-hmm.
There's a letter from Albert Frick Associates Incorporated, which came in our package this month, which does two things which I'm not sure or might not be contradictory. One, it says the existing system is okay, after it was investigated in the field, mm-hmm. and then two, it proposes a whole new system. Is it in fact the new system which is proposed, is it in fact a system proposed to be constructed presently, or is it a proposed replacement?
The new system,
if the first system ever failed.
That's exactly what it is, and I believe it's a state law that we have a proposed backup system in case the present system fails. Ernie McVane had requested that we come up with a backup system in case the present one fails, which is what that is. It's a backup system.
I think that was in response to a memo, actually to Maureen, March 3rd, from Ernie McVane, saying that it's his interpretation that was state law, plumbing code, part two, so that the applicant has to provide a replacement design.
Yeah. The original letter from Mr. McVane said he considered the new use to be an increased use from the current use. Mr. Frick's letter, in essence, also says the same thing, that because of the dippers or whatnot, that there is a higher anticipated water usage for this property at this point in time. And Mr. Frick's letter does not say anywhere in the letter the intention to keep the existing system in service. It merely says that the existing system does not have organic buildup, and here's a design for a new system. So nowhere in what we've been presented does it say that it's okay to continue using the existing system for the new use. To the contrary, we have a letter from Mr. McVane saying it's an expansion of use, which under state plumbing code requires an expansion of the septic system. Is it possible to... is there anybody else who's concerned with that?
If I could just maybe add to some of this information, I think the main problem we have is the problem that we have with most existing septic systems is that we can't locate the design for the existing system. So we really don't know what the capacity of it is unless we dig it up, in which case it's not been destroyed. So what we've done with previous applicants is that if we think that the existing system will continue to function appropriately, we've asked them to show us where there's a site where they can replace the system if necessary, or where they can hook up to sewer. And I think Mr. McVane would agree that if that system malfunctions, he will expect them to install a new system, which is what this applicant is trying to demonstrate, that they do have a site where they could put a new system in that would meet our current requirements.
Okay.
Because they're opting not to hook up to sewer.
I would say
if Mr. McVane finds that is satisfactory and the planner finds that satisfactory, then
fine. Just for the board's information, he has reviewed this submitted form and found it acceptable.
Yes. I'd like to add one thing which may perhaps touch on the issue of completeness, which is that the proposed replacement system is located in such a manner that when Mr. Frick's plan is overlaid upon Mr. McDonald's plan, the base system goes across the property line onto land which is not controlled under the lease which is being shown, and the fill extensions on the north and northwest corner also go about 20 or 25 feet onto the area on the plan now that's called out as mixed growth, 340 feet. To some extent, then, it seems to me, at any rate, that there should be some example of the fact that the next-door neighbor agrees to that, that's being done on land controlled by the applicant.
I understand the point.
In order to be part of the application.
And I'm trying to weigh it back and forth, whether it's an issue of completeness or whether we're getting some substantive review. I have a
real strong concern about the septic system myself, and we'll go into it in some detail.
Is this on land not owned by the owner?
Okay, I understand. And again, Judy's always our expert on completeness, trying to keep us away from technical merit versus completeness.
I would say this is not a question of completeness, that they are showing septic and proposed septic, and you may say it's inadequate, we might also, but we will discuss that afterwards.
But there is a point in that, right or wrong. It's there. Or, you know, is what's there a level that we can start with review? Judy? You had that question look in your eye. Any other questions about the uncompleteness? On appearing, do I hear a motion? Okay. Judy?
Propose the following motion for the board to consider. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Beals Ice Cream for site plan review of a change of use from a fish and farm market to an ice cream store located at 330 Ocean House Road be deemed complete.
It's been moved.
Second.
And seconded. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion as read, please raise your right hand. Opposed? Is deemed complete. The issue, at this point in time, the board has the option of scheduling a public hearing. What's the consensus of the board for public hearings? Judy?
I would favor a public hearing, but there are a few issues that I would like to see the applicant be looking at prior to a public hearing, and I would like to discuss a few of those before we schedule a public hearing, and in which case table it to the next meeting and hold a public hearing at that meeting.
At the next meeting?
Yes. Okay. That's what I would like to do.
Okay. And continue to discuss for a brief point after this discussion.
Yes.
Okay. Yep, that's certainly an option for us. Do I hear a motion for public hearing?
Can we make it after discussion or not?
Sure. Is that okay with the board members? Any points of discussion, Judy?
And I'm not looking for answers right now, Mr. Melia. I'm curious how the number of parking spaces was determined. When I looked at the zoning ordinance, your use is not specified in there, and it has how you compute parking spaces for different uses. I would like to see your justification. My concern, and it's kind of tied into the landscaping, is I don't personally like the appearance of the two parking spaces that are cutting into that nice grassed area. If this is the number of spaces you need, perhaps you need to look at some landscaping to obscure that a little bit. That's only this board member's opinion. I would be looking for some sort of landscaping plan on there. You have areas of the existing driveway you're proposing to discontinue. I presume perhaps you were going to be digging that up a little bit and grassing that, but that should be noted on the plan. I would like to see more information on the signs. I understand those are in the works, but whatever you can give us, I would like to look at. There is some confusion on my part. What exactly, or where exactly the ice cream shop will be, it's not clear if it is located only in the fish and farm market or if there will be some takeout function in the shed, if you could clarify that. When you talked about lighting, you indicated more lights than are actually shown on the plan. At a minimum, I think all the lights, unless I missed them, all the lights should be marked on the plan. And perhaps you could discuss with Maureen what else the town engineer would be looking for to be represented on the plans. I'm not sure what that is, but please address that before you come back. And certainly, since Mr. Wilcox raised this issue of the replacement septic system possibly not being on the property you're going to lease, that needs to be clarified. I think those are my concerns.
Any others? I think what the board is trying to make sure that you have some sense of what we will be looking for. Ms. Lardner's point is that she'd like some of these issues in the next packet, if possible, so that members of the public, if they have an interest in making comment, they'll have the same information, and mm-hmm. so it's not brought up, and then people wish they had a chance to make public comment. We're just as apt to, mm-hmm. as fickle as we are, to schedule another public hearing.
Most of them are fairly clear. I'm just not sure on a couple of them. If we're not proposing to really make any changes in the existing landscape, architecture. I'm just not sure what sort of landscape plan you want to see.
I guess at a minimum, your plan shows the existing drive, and then it shows what's proposed, and clearly you're creating some new parking areas. But it appears to me that in some cases, your proposed drive is not covering completely the existing drive. If it's not a drafting error and you are discontinuing small portions of that existing drive, I would assume you're going to grass it or something. And just to propose that, if you're not proposing further landscaping, I'm sure we're going to hear from Mr. Emery next month if he should be, but I think you should come forth with some minimal proposal.
And, okay, the other issue that I wasn't sure on was the signage. There's a signpost, existing signpost here, which we would like to use if possible, and we understand that, as I understand it, the sign cannot exceed 40 square feet. Once again, that's in the right-of-way, so we're still not sure if we can use that one there, but that's what we'd like to use, and then there's an overhang here. What would you be looking for as far as...
At a minimum, first off, I think you should clarify, starting with the town planner and talking to whoever else is necessary, whether you can continue to have a sign in the right-of-way, and if so, if you can also post the directional signs in the right-of-way. I agree they make the most sense in the right-of-way where people can see them. If you can do that, or if you can't, give us a new location for the signs. Show us the dimension of the sign you're proposing, material, if you know the material. You have submitted a rendering of the facade. You could indicate the size of the sign you would be posting on the building if that's what you're doing. So give us a sense. It sometimes is very simple, but we can look. And if there's extra proposed lighting or no lighting, something of that nature.
Okay, thank you.
I think there will be an issue whether the board can approve, and I might turn to Maureen on this, whether we can actually approve a sign in the right of way, or whether it would be prudent for the board to do that. I think there may be a question that you may want to receive permission from the town. We certainly realize it exists there, mm-hmm. but for us to reapprove something in the town right of way, and one of our charges is to protect the public health and safety, to put it in the traffic right of way, I'm not sure that we can prove that without permission from the town.
The code enforcement officer and I have spoken with the applicant, and the code enforcement officer has recommended that he speak with the Department of Transportation office in Scarborough, since it's a state road right-of-way, and determine whether they will allow him permission to leave it there, and if they'll give him permission, then the code officer has no problem with it. In terms of directional signage, I see no problem. I believe that it's allowed as part of the sign ordinance, that any kind of traffic control signage is automatically allowed in the right-of-way.
We actually received an application from the Department of Transportation, so we'll proceed with that.
If you combine them and say ice cream this way, is that okay?
Exit.
Okay.
And typically, with respect to those directional signs, we often do see renderings of those, don't we?
Usually the location is noted on the plan, just so you have a guarantee that it's actually going to be installed. Sometimes we see an actual rendering of them. Sometimes it's just, you know, a note, a 2x3 sign, exit or entrance. I know with a subdivision we had just a stop sign noted, and everyone assumed what we knew what the stop sign would look like.
Yeah, I would hope that we would at least know the dimensions of that sign. I'd hate to see, you know, a big 4x10 enter here sign considered directional sign.
Other comments?
Okay.
I'd just say that I would like to see a little more clarification specifically on the issues of how the butterfat will be treated going into the septic system. Ice cream industries historically has some notoriety for being tough on septic systems and what you can do to prevent and the cloggage of that type of system.
Actually, there's a quick response to that. I think you have a letter from Al Frick. Did you get this one? Oh, you didn't get this. We'll give you this one for next time. It's the strength of the wastewater that we'll be using, and he says that the takeout stand serving ice cream without food preparation and dishwashing will have an anticipated wastewater strength equal to or less than domestic wastewater. So we'll give you that letter for next time. It's just a small trickle into your dipping well, which is a very, very small, steady trickle, almost like leaving your faucet on in the morning, and that's just to clean the leftover ice cream off the scoop. So that's what Al Frick did a study on that sort of thing. One other question I had, can I ask a question?
Sure.
The site distances, is that going to be a problem, the site distances that our engineer did? Or
I think if it's
there's a slight difference
delineated in the ordinance. Is it ordinance reference of how it's calculated, and then you have to do it the way that the ordinance says? I think that's what our engineer is quoting.
Okay.
Mark?
There's one other item which the town engineer responded to, which was his concern with waiving site sections.
Yes.
Details, in fact, of what the construction is to be. I'm assuming that areas which are shown as parking now, which are specifically parking spaces number 4 and 5, are not in fact just parking on the grass, but that there will be some sort of new construction plan for that area and some sort of documentation of what the materials are to be used, I think would be of merit.
Any other comments? Judy, ready to make a motion for a public hearing?
Be it ordered that the application of Beals Ice Cream be tabled to the regular May 18th, 1993 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
It's been moved. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a unanimous vote. See you next month.
Okay, just a procedural question. As you know, it's kind of getting late in mid-May. We're talking now, and I'm just wondering what the procedure is for the public hearing. If we address all these items sufficiently, is it possible that it will be approved next month, or will that have to wait till June, or I just wondering what the procedure is.
I would say procedurally, there is the possibility that an article can be approved after a public hearing. I don't know why. You can't. I'm certainly not going to say that it will be. I think if you paid close attention to every item that was mentioned here tonight, the probability is higher. Certainly understand your interest in getting started. I'll also say there's a great demand in Cape Elizabeth for year-round consumption of ice cream.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I heard. But.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Just before you leave, and I'm sorry to make this outside to sort of the closing of the business, there are a couple of issues raised by concerned citizens that you probably should be aware of. Number one, the lighting hours, hours of operation of business, and the lighting, how the lighting proposed associated with the hours that you intend to be open.
Okay.
Okay. Those are seen to me. Orders of new business, the Duckett subdivision amendment, a request by Gordon Duckett for an amendment of the Elizabeth Farm subdivision, adjusting the building envelope for lot 34C to bring the structure into conformance, section 16-2-5, subdivision ordinance. Ask the applicant to come to the podium and identify yourself and give us a quick description of what you're proposing.
Yeah, my name is Bob Kozinski. I'm representing Gordon Duckett, who is asking for an amendment to the subdivision to increase his building envelope approximately 201 square feet on the southeasterly corner to accommodate the building, the existing building.
Okay. Pretty straightforward request. As far as procedure, we simply can proceed
without dealing with any completeness issue. I open this to discussion. Any questions going to the applicant? Judy?
This is more, I think, a question for Maureen. In our memo, there's an issue raised regarding a 30-foot minimum setback, and that this revision may, I believe, violate that. Is the idea that we will be signing a recording plat, and we just want a note added to the plat to indicate that this is not to conflict with the existing recorded plat?
Yes. It's just in past reviews of the Elizabeth Farm subdivision file, which is set a couple of feet deep, I have from time to time seen a note like saying that it's 30 feet, things should be 30 feet in width. And I think just to make sure that there's never any problem in the future, that adding a note would be a good idea. The applicant has actually prepared a recording plat subsequent to the one you have, where he has added a note on it that states